Good afternoon, good morning, everyone. I hope that you could hear okay. If there are any audio questions or any problems, just let me know in the chat or raise your hand. We're still waiting for the presenter to join us. He might be having a little bit of technical difficulty. Just trying to resolve that, but just give us a few more minutes and we'll start soon. Thank you.
Hi there. Hi, Tommy. Now I can hear you.
Great. Everything. You sound good. Yes. This is good to know. So if you're ready to go, we're ready to introduce you.
Sure.
Okay.
Great. Hi. Welcome, everybody. My name is Chad Cusco. I'm the operations manager here at the NERI LEHIGH facility. Thank you for taking the time to join us for this next seminar as part of our ever-expanding NERI LEHIGH seminar series that will continue on this semester and through the spring 2018 semester. Today's presentation is entitled Expanding Resilience-Based Design of Steel and Steel Concrete Composite Structures from Short-Term Extreme Loads to Long-Term Deterioration Mechanisms, presented by Theodore Karavasilis, Professor, University of Southampton. Theodore is a full professor and head of structural engineering at the University of Southampton, where he leads a research group working on structural resilience of steel and steel concrete composite structures. He holds a diploma in civil engineering, a master of science in structural engineering, and a PhD in seismic design of steel structures from the University of Patras. We appreciate Theodore's time today and look forward to his presentation. Thank you.
Okay, so you are, you're ready to share when you are you're ready to go when your presentation is up. Go ahead. So you just need to share the screen. Perfect.
Okay. Can you see now my presentation? Yeah. We're good. Oh, sorry. For some reason, I need to unmute. So Tommy, now can you see the presentation?
Yes, we can see you.
Okay. Thank you very much, and I will let you very much, Todd, for the introduction, and of course Jim Rickles and everybody in the Atlas Center that I used to also to work for 2 years. This is a great opportunity to present my work. So what I'm gonna do today is I'm gonna just describe you some recent work that we have done on resilience based design of steel and composite structures. The main goal of this presentation is, of course, because it's 40 minutes, I can't really go into deep details, but what I would like to emphasize is some work that we have done to try to move the concept of resilience-based design from short-term extreme loads to long-term deterioration mechanisms. So here is the outline of the presentation. So essentially, the first thing that I would like to discuss is the overall concept of resilience for short-term extreme loads. And essentially, what I will do is, here you see a graph, essentially, structural health in the vertical axis, lifespan in the horizontal axis. At time T0, we have the occurrence of an extreme event, and of course, then it takes some time to bring the system back. So what we really, if we then compare a resilient with a non-resilient structure for this case of extreme load, then of course for a non-resilient structure, it will take some time to bring up the system to 100% again structural health. But if we design a system to be resilient, then we have a short repair time. This is an area that, in my opinion, now is considered in terms of research, but also implementation to practice as a mature area. So for specific extreme loads like earthquakes, for instance, we think now that we are capable of achieving that. What I would like to before I move on to the concept of resilience for long-term deterioration mechanisms, I just want to show you a few results that we got from a recent project, collaborative project between Heriot-Watt University in Edinburgh and University of Southampton in the UK on resilience of steel braced frames. And essentially the reason that we did this work was because we wanted to emphasize that you really don't need to use really advanced technologies to achieve resilience. And just to explain what I mean with that, essentially what we started of thinking of what we want to essentially, what are the mechanical characteristics that our braced frames will have to achieve resilience. So, of course, one of the first things that we would like to have is large stiffness to control drifts and damage in drift-sensitive structural elements. Our braces will be equipped with a kind of a removable yielding device so that we can, after the earthquake, damage will be isolated there and we can remove it and replace it so that we can achieve resilience. Then another requirement is that the yielding devices should be made of a material that has large hardening, because we know now that the high post yield stiffness ratio reduces residual drifts. And then we need also to have a friction mechanism in the braces, because we really want to control the peak in the braces, and so the peak base shear force and floor acceleration. How we do that, the configuration that we use to support this idea is basically, you can see it here. We use stainless steel as a material because this material is known to have very high hardening, post yield stiffness ratio. And here you see the configuration that we choose for the double stainless steel pins that we try to dissipate energy. We have additional some beam fuses to avoid damage in the main structural element in the beams. And here are the friction pads. We did a lot of tests on that. I'll show you just a video on showing how these devices, that they have this hourglass shape, as you can see, they can distribute uniformly plastic deformations. Then we got a prototype building that was designed using these devices. We extracted devices from the last story, also from the third story, and we started testing the devices in this setup, as you can see. We did constant W tests, increasing amplitude tests, and also random loading protocols. We got this hysteresis. And also, as you can see here, from the typical Coffin-Munson equation that was fitted in the constant amplitude test results, these devices, they have like a very large fracture capacity, essentially. And then we did a little bit of comparison with the typical buckling restraint braces. You see here the difference. You have the same, exactly the same point that you have softening in the base shear roof drift behavior. However, you see the very large post-yield stiffness ratio of the stainless steel, and here the expression of the friction pads. So this effect results in some control, as you can see in these time histories, of residual deformations under the design earthquake and the maximum earthquake. And here you can see, again, the performance of this system in comparison to a BRB, the structure equipped with BRBs, how basically you can control residual drifts under the maximum considered earthquake. And also we did some collapse simulations, and we got this very low probability of collapse. So the main thing that I wanted essentially to emphasize here is that essentially we can have the resilience is essentially achievable for earthquakes in a simple manner. So essentially we used only some stainless steel devices and friction pans. We don't really need to use advanced things like viscoelastic or viscous dampers that I have done a lot of work on this or anything else. With a simple stainless steel device that has specific properties, we can achieve very good performance and ensure resilience for a steel building, even under the intensities higher than the design earthquake. Of course, I think in terms also, because this presentation is as part of the NIRI program, it's very good that work has been initiated with other natural or man-made hazards. And on this, I just want to mention that in the structural engineering group that I have the privilege to lead at the University of Southampton, we have a very strong blast engineering research group with large research contracts with the Ministry of Defense and research councils doing advanced simulations and experiments to investigate whether we can achieve resilience under blast loading as well. So continuing my presentation, I would like now to move to the concept of resilience against long-term deterioration mechanisms. And essentially, here the concept is that we may have a structure that it is under the effect of corrosion or fatigue. So again, at time T0, we can have the detection of damage through inspection or through indications of the structural program. So again, we need to bring the structure back to 100% structural strength, and essentially, this needs a lot of, again, may need a lot of time. So a non-resilient structure will look like this. In this case, that we have a long-term deterioration mechanism, but the resilient structure will, of course, we can't avoid deterioration, but we can, basically, if we design the structure in a smart way, we can reduce considerably the repair time, so we can talk about a resilient structure under long-term deterioration mechanism. So after introducing this concept, what I would like to do is to discuss what we have done on this topic, which is quite new, trying to apply resilience-based design for composite bridges in corrosive environments. So here, just an introduction of steel concrete composite bridges. You know, these bridges are very efficient. They have superior stiffness strength, offer speed installation and economy. The typical, of course, we know the typical way that we that are constructed are a steel beam, welded shear studs, and then shear studs are fully embedded in the concrete monolithic connection and composite action. So the problem here is that if you are in a corrosive environment or if you have heavy traffic loading leading to fatigue, essentially, the question is what you can do for that and how you're going to repair your deteriorating deck. Because in steel composite bridges, we achieve composite action through this connection of welded shear studs. The only way is essentially to crush the concrete or drill the concrete. And this is, of course, an action that takes a lot of time to achieve. So we have long traffic interruption and associated socioeconomic losses. So this was a problem. We have identified this problem, so we try to address this issue. So how we can do that? Essentially, we say that the extension of the bridge lifespan, so essentially repair of the bridge should become, and the way that you will repair the bridge should become one of the main initial design goals, should become part of the design procedure. So one way to do that is to design bridges for disassembly without compromising structural performance. And disassembly, of course, will offer the unique advantage of easy or rapid replacement of deteriorating structural components like the whole deck or the shear studs with minimum disturbance to traffic flow. And also, I have to say that also during this research program, we identified that if you try to design the structure, of course, for disassembly, you will typically offer also an accelerated bridge construction concept. Essentially, the bridge will be also rapidly constructed. So what we did here is essentially, if you try to design a steel concrete composite bridge for disassembly, essentially what you want is to a demountable shear connector that will allow rapid and easy separation of the slab from the beam. So essentially we cannot use this anymore, which is standard practice, but we need to develop something else. And if this happens at the time that we will detect severe corrosion on our deck and we will need to replace our bridge, we will essentially can, through disassembly, we can disassemble the bridge, replace the deteriorating deck with a new one and reduce considerably repair time. So here the main research goal of this program was to, we wanted the bridge that it is prefabricated, a shear connector that it is demountable, has a very good shear resistance, shear stiffness, slip capacity, ductility and uplift resistance at least equal to welded shear studs, but at the same time being demountable. So we started seeing first the state of the art on this field. So one of the very good works in this area was the work conducted by Professor Bradford at UNSW in Australia. So here you see the concept proposed by these researchers and essentially the load slip displacement behavior that you get. However, as you can see here, you have this large slip behavior. I guess designers won't be really comfortable of using something like this because of that. However, this is a very good, I think, development as the first attempt at least. But it has other problems also, that the gaps that you may have in the interface between the steel beam and the precast slab may prevent adequate bolt fastening and create cracking in the slab. Of course, you have this slip of the bolt that creates, as you can see, this slipping behavior here that you can see in the graphs. But again, the system has some good strength and slip capacity, we have to say, and also the slab and shear connector are removable. It has though these disadvantages that I mentioned. Another development is from the UK, from Professor Lamb from the University of Bradford, using these demountable shear bolts to connect the steel beam with the slab. But as you can see here also, because of the slip of these bolts inside the bolt hole, you have this lower stiffness compared to the initial stiffness of the welded shear stud. Also, this shear connector is fully embedded in the concrete. So again, you can't really do much to replace it. I'll just now describe to you what we did in terms of this research. We developed this, the locking nut shear connector, and here are the main components of the connector. It seems in the first instance as a little bit of complicated. However, it's very easy to construct and to deconstruct to achieve disassembly. So I'll just describe to you now as a first step the construction process for this connector. So the main thing is that you have here a pair of high strength steel bolts which are fastened at the upper beam flange, as you can see here. Bolting is achieved with a carefully designed double nut configuration. You see the two nuts here. The bolt hole has a chamfered, you see the chamfered finish following a 60 degree angle to form a countersunk seat. The upper nut has a conical shape to fit in the countersunk seat. As you can see here, you see the nut here that you can fit inside the bolt. And the lower nut is a standard nut, basically that you can fasten. And if you fasten this nut, essentially you prevent the bolt to slip. So if you do all this, the beam will look like this at the end, and you can simply transfer the beam to the side. And then If you do that, then the second construction step is that you need, of course, to prefabricate the slabs. You see the slabs are prefabricated by having a 5-degree inclination tapered holes, as you can see here. And the only thing that you can do then is just, you need to do is just transfer the slabs to the side, put them on the top of the steel beam, approximately with the center of the bolts will be in the center of the hole. So we don't raise any construction tolerance issues, which is really important. And then essentially the third step to finalize the construction process is that we have two inverted conical precast unit plugs, as you can see here. And these precast plugs are positioned in the slab pocket. They have a circular hole, as you can see here, to accommodate, again, a bolt, but without any, again, construction tolerance issues. And then all the interfaces or the gaps between the slab, the plug, and the plug and the bolt are filled with cement grout, a flowable grout, and before this grout is before we have hardening of this grout, we need essentially to tighten this nut on the top of the plug, and this finishes the shear connector. There is a lot of a whole of a history why we decided to do these steps, and I will describe in the next slides. But it's very important to see what you can achieve with this connector. So if you have a bridge with that and you just notice that you have deterioration because of corrosion or any other issues in your concrete slabs, you essentially unfasten this bolt here so the whole slab with the shear connectors can be uplifted as a whole and replaced really rapidly. Instead of breaking a concrete slab when we have welded shear studs. So that's the huge advantage. But you can also, it's very important that you can also, if you use these techniques that we used in the lab with manpower and by using the slab as support and simple couplers here, you can remove the shear connector itself because you can use an agent between the precast slab and you can use an agent in the internal face of the precast slab that will not allow any chemical bond between the concrete of the slab and the grout after hardening. So you can also remove the shear connector. But what is really interesting is to see the mechanical behavior of this connector, because the main goal of the research program was to achieve a shear connector with at least the same characteristics with the welded shear stud, but having at the same time the demountability advantage. We did a standard push-out test in the lab, as you can see here, according to Eurocode 4. It's a standard way of testing shear connectors. And we choose to use this essentially test setup, although it has some disadvantages. We choose to do that because we wanted our results to be fully comparable with results of welded shear studs. So I just show you here the experimental program. It was a fairly large experimental program covering using 12 specimens. The first 5 specimens all failed in a way they were using details not exactly the same as those that I previously described. So these 6 tests actually were iterative until we could optimize the structural details of the connector. But let's see now 3 identical tests for M16 bolts of quality 8.8. So you see 3 tests having negligible scatter in the load, in the shear load slip displacement behavior. Absolutely no slip of the bolt, although we used a shear connector, a bolt, an actual bolt. Superior strength, a characteristic value for an M16 bolt of 800 megapascals, ultimate strength of 171 kilonewtons, superior stiffness 100 kilonewtons per millimeter at 50% at the shear load equal to 50% of shear strength, and superior slip displacement more than 12 millimeters. So all these values are significantly higher than what you can achieve with an M16 bolt welded stud, but with a standard quality of, let's say, 355 megapascals ultimate strain. That you can, of course, weld on a standard quality steel beam in practice. I just need to show you also to emphasize on the variation in the structural behavior. So you see here the very small variation that we got in the behavior of the shear connector of the LNC connector by doing three identical tests. And see, and here is what you can get from three identical tests from shear studs. These results are published in ASE, Journal of Bridge Engineering, where our work is also published recently. So you can see here with what uncertainty, essentially, we designed here the shear studs, and here what you can achieve with the shear connector that we developed. And also, I just want to discuss the resistance of this connector against slab uplift. Again, a very strong connector. There is no way of your slab under any moments in the bridge or traffic loads to experience severe uplift. Actually, the uplift will be much smaller than what you achieve with welded shear studs because you have the concepts that I described. Here is a little bit of the effect of the plug concrete strength. As you can see, even if you use different concrete strength for the plugs with different cylinder strength, compressive strength, you can achieve similar behavior, not a significant influence. And then we, of course, developed also a very using fundamental structural mechanics and equation where you could predict essentially the shear resistance of the connector. As you can see here, a very good fit to the experimental results, an absolute error less than 8% for all the experimental tests. And I just want now to summarize this work, because I just want to say, okay, why this shear connector looks like this and why it can achieve this very high stiffness strength slip capacity and low variability in the shear load slip displacement behavior, and also having the unique advantage of being demountable. First of all, we use a high strength 800 megapascals ultimate strength bolt. Here is the bolt. You take advantage of the high strength of the material. Of course, now the question is that if you embed a very high strength steel bolt within the concrete slab, you expect, of course, the concrete to fail. So the main research question that we had is how, for the first time in the literature, we make a high strength steel bolt to fail before without failing the concrete. So we have dowel action without failing the concrete. So to do that, here, as you can see, this has been, as I said, is tightened, this bolt, this high strength bolt to the proof load. And so this concrete plug here, the concrete of the plug, is essentially under nearly triaxial strength confinement condition. This means that this concrete here has 8 or 10 times the cylinder strength. So essentially we have a concrete that has a very high strength that cannot fail even under the bearing forces of a high strength steel bolt. So the smart concept of this connector is that it will always drive failure in a high strength steel bolt without crushing the concrete. And also, there is another trick here that we do. If you can see this comment here, that the LNC ensures that the shear failure in the bolts takes place in the unthreaded length. So you see here that the threads are essentially hidden within this nut. So essentially, the shear failure will be actually at this point where you have the unthreaded section of the bolt. So you have more cross-section and more material to get. And one, the main reason that we get this low variability is that, you know, in a conventional welded shear stud, which is directly embedded in the concrete slab, you get some variability because you have variation of voids and aggregates of the concrete around the steel bolt. However, in this case, we use with this dark gray flowable grout. So essentially, we don't get this variation in the shear load slip displacement behavior because of the variability in the voids and aggregates. And you can find more details on this shear connector. It's a paper that has been recently published. and for future publications and updates on this research, because we continue this research program with additional funding that we recently managed to get on my personal webpage. I have to say that we recently completed these beam tests and the shear connector, even in a full-scale 10-meter beam, worked perfectly fine. Essentially, we saw the same behavior that we see in the push-out tests. And after all that, I just want to go to the conclusions, to summarize what I have discussed. So it is my opinion, and that's why we push this really hard at Southampton with my research group. We push resilience-based design to progress really to cover both short-term extreme loads, but also long-term deterioration mechanisms, because I think it is a grand challenge to make the built environment resilient, not only to an extreme earthquake, but also to mechanisms that will cause deterioration and damage to the structure through a long period of time. In my opinion, resilience-based design is now a mature area for earthquakes, at least for steel structures that I work, but progress is needed in other extreme natural and man-made hazards, according also to the philosophy of the NIRI program. We have a research a very strong research group with a lot of activity in blast effects on structures, working mainly on robustness, but having also as a target in the future to address resilience. In terms of the earthquake resilience, as I said, for instance, I just described a research program that with not so complex structural details, without using a rocking concept or a post-tension concept or something like this, with simple removable yielding devices by using stainless steel instead of mild steel, and by having also a friction element, we can achieve resilience under strong earthquakes. And in terms of resilience in composite bridges against corrosion or fatigue, this again seems achievable by using shear connectors that are structurally efficient and allow also bridge disassembly. And in terms of the LNC shear connector that I just described, I just want to emphasize the merits that it is removable, but also has significantly better mechanical characteristics, strength, stiffness, slip capacity, resistance to slab uplift in comparison to welded shear studs. And I just need, of course, to acknowledge the EPSRC is the Engineering and Physical Science Research Council of the UK, that they funded this work through the Impact Acceleration Fund. And I just want to say that this is something equivalent to NSF in the United States. And with this, to thank you very much for your attention.
Great, thank you, Theodore. So at this time, we're going to open the forum for questions. You can either raise your hand in the participants window and then I will unmute you, or you can ask in the Zoom chat. And we already have a question in the chat. I will read it. It says, after you do a resilience-based design, how can you quantify the actual resilience performance? So Theodore.
Yeah, I mean, you will typically to do a life cycle cost assessment, essentially. You need to consider the whole lifespan of the structure, consider different events through the lifespan of the structure, and just quantify resilience in terms of losses that you will have during the lifespan. So for earthquakes, we have done recently some work on economic loss estimation of resilient steel frames using different technologies like viscous dampers or post-tensioning technology for self-centering frames. And we did different comparisons between different technologies. But to do formally a quantification of resilience, essentially, and consider resilience is a very general concept. You can also study different dimensions of the resilience. But as structural engineers, I think we can start designing structures having as target to minimize economic loss and downtime through the lifespan of the structure.
And then there's a follow-up to that. But would that wouldn't be a direct measure of resilience?
A direct measure of, it's very difficult to answer this question because, as I said, resilience is a concept that has different dimensions. In terms of the research that I do, I always try to quantify resilience in terms of economic loss estimation. But since deterioration or failure of structural systems can have other dimensions in terms of impact on society overall and so on and so on, it's it will be very difficult, that I think, to answer this question. We need to refer to specific publications in the literature that they develop resilient indices by considering the concept of resilience in a more holistic way. In our, if you like, narrow structural engineering work, we so far in my research group, we quantify economic loss.
Okay, great. Thank you. Are there any other questions? Okay, going once, going twice. Okay, Theodore, thank you again for, oh, we have one more. Okay, it's coming in the chat, I suppose, so let's see. Okay. Can we get a copy of this presentation? Do you want to make this available?
For sure, yeah. I'll create a PDF and send it to you, and you can distribute to...
You can upload it
on any site or make it available to people that they want to download it and so on, yes.
Right. With your permission, we will archive this on the DesignSafe website so that people can view the presentation and or if you would like this recording, because we did record this presentation. So with your permission, we could talk offline about that.
Okay, sure.
It'll be available. So from Alejandro, it says there's a question. How far are we from implementing this worldwide? And I will unmute you.
Implementing, depending, we are talking now because the presentation was quite general. The earthquake resilience, we talked about earthquake resilience or resilience against long-term deterioration mechanisms. If Alejandro can clarify this, because...
Yeah, I'm talking about the bolt systems, about how far are we from implementing them in standards, like...
The bolted shear studs.
Yeah.
Yes. It's unfortunately we are. This is preliminary research stages. You know, it's we did this. We just published this imagine, and it needs a lot of work to be done. The first thing is first of all to study the fatigue behavior of a bridge using the shear connectors, because we need to make sure that under, let's say, after 50 years, the shear connector will still be there and have the same mechanical characteristics. So we need to evaluate the fatigue life of the connector. So we are starting now a research program on this. But also there are too many things also to be done, because to get the confidence and, if you like, to develop the safety factors through a formal reliability procedure, you have more experimental results. You need to have possibly numerical models to replicate the behavior, to do parametric studies and so on and so on. You need to test at the end, if you like, a model, a large scale bridge with this. And then I think it can be slowly pushed to the design standards.
Thank you very much.
Okay, great. Thank you. Let's just see if anyone else has any further questions. Okay, so it seems not, Theodore. Again, thank you for your time. We appreciate you giving us this seminar. And if anyone wants to follow up with you, can they through email, any other contacts you would like to give out?
I mean, I need to say that I will be more than happy to respond to any questions through email. And I would like to thank you, Tommy, and also Chad, and all the people in Atlas Center, and thank you very much. Also the NIRI program for supporting this. Thank you very much for inviting me. It was great to give the seminar to you.
Great. We appreciate that very much. And we will be continuing this seminar series with LEHIGH. Just keep an eye on your email and on the DesignSafe website. You will see postings there if you would like to register for following seminars that we will be producing. So at this time, we're going to end this meeting, and we thank everyone for your time and participation.
Thank you very much.